Ik zie het Sartre, Wittgenstein of Aristoteles. Nog niet 1, 2, 3 doen. Na afloop van een lange middag praten, vol emoties, een half uur op de Stairmaster. Maar ze heeft het zelf voorgesteld. Rennen is één van haar bronnen van schoonheid en troost. Versplinterde, droomachtige ideeën doen me tijdens het hardlopen op. Als ik wandel, kan ik filosofie bedrijven. Niet als ik ren, schreef ze me. Meestal rende ik rond het meer hier. Ik houd van de kleuren. Pastelachtig, nevelachtig, nooit fel, altijd omvloerst. De kleuren van het meer en de hemel erboven en het vermoeden van de stad in de verte. Dit is dus Martha Nussbaum, een van de meest intrigerende filosofen van dit moment. Lees alleen haar boek The Fragility of Goodness, de kwetsbaarheid van het goede, en je begrijpt waarom. Dit is een filosofe die de filosofie niet beoefent om het dwarrelend gedachtenspel alleen. Dit is iemand voor wie de filosofie praktische betekenis moet hebben, een morele betekenis, zo je wilt. Maar is het daar de afgelopen uren ook over gegaan? De humanitaire filosofie als bron van schoonheid en troost. Op het moment van onze ontmoeting is de filosoof Nussbaum druk bezig met het schrijven van een lijvig boek. Onderwerp: de emoties. Is het eigenlijk over iets anders gegaan? De lange middag die achter ons ligt.
What's the difference, Martha Nussbaum, before the running or after?
Oh, I don't, you know, I just feel very relaxed and feel very, very good. And, you know, I think more important, if I didn't do it, then I'd feel really terrible, like in a day. I would just feel crabby and unhappy. So it's more like the long term than the short term effect. But I feel very relaxed and I like feeling sweaty.
What kind of music did you hear? Oh, not any.
First movement of Beethoven's first piano concerto. I used to play that when I was a kid, although I played the third movement, not the first movement, but I like that. It's a good, you know, da 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 da. It's very good for kind of keeping you going when you're going up the steps. So, yeah, I think the Stairmaster is not as pleasant as running. I mean, it's very static. You don't feel the wind in your face. You don't see interesting things around you. But in the winter, when it's too cold to run outside or there's snow on the ground, it's a good thing. I like running on the treadmill too, but you can't actually have a treadmill. It's hard to have a treadmill in an apartment because it uses more power than the Stairmaster, and apparently it blows fuses in this building all the time. So I would, otherwise I would get a treadmill because I would enjoy that more.
Are you coming to take a shower or?
Yeah.
And then you come to the opera?
Yes, yes. I have to leave for the opera by 6:30 at latest, so.
What kind of opera?
La Bohème.
La Bohème?
Yeah.
Okay.
With Mirella Freini making her farewell tour. She's 60 now, but she's still singing Mimi. But, now, what should we do? Do you want to just pack up while I take a shower? And
you take a shower.
And you put this back, yeah?
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Because I can't carry this. But then I'll say goodbye to you before you go,
okay.
Of course. Okay.
Oh, zeker. Het is gegaan de afgelopen 5 uur over de kwetsbaarheid van het goede. Het is gegaan over de filosofie als een bron van schoonheid en troost. Over Sophocles hebben we gepraat. en over de vrije wil als de sine qua non voor een volwaardig leven. Maar meer nog, ja eigenlijk voortdurend, ging het over hem, vader Nussbaum, en over haar, moeder Nussbaum, en over het kind tussen hen in. We hadden er alleen terloops over zullen praten, maar tenslotte ging het over weinig anders meer. Over vader ging het, over moeder ging het, en over de vraag of er troost is als we sterven.
Shall we start?
Yeah. Okay.
Let's start at the very beginning.
Okay.
Oliver Sacks sent me once in New York. In our childhood, we lived in an Arcadian state. The rest of our lives, we tried to recapture that state, even if it didn't exist at all. What about your childhood?
I think the beginning of it was very happy. I remember being held by my mother and being just very happy to be near her. She was very beautiful, very warm. My parents seemed then happy together, and I adored my father. My father was full of life. He was just a strong and very vital person, and he adored me. So he would take me swimming when I was about 4 or 5, and I didn't know how to swim yet, but he would take me into the sea, and we'd go out beyond the breakers, and he'd carry me on his back, and then we'd do a little swimming out there, and then we'd have to come back through the breakers together, and it was a big adventure. And so my father was like my companion in adventure, and he would teach me to get through the breakers, even if I kind of got my nose full of salt water sometimes. And the lesson was you could get through anything and you could be really, really strong. And so I just adored that. I felt that I could do anything. And so it was a very, very happy time. I mean, I felt like I could do what I wanted to do and that people loved me and I loved them. But it didn't always stay so happy. When I was around 9 or 10, we moved to a house. We had been living in an apartment, and we moved to a house that was nice, but somehow it made my father anxious because he spent all the time outside trying to mow the lawn and make it look perfect. And then my mother started drinking a lot. So my memory from that time on was that my mother would get drunk, and my father would get angry, and he would storm out of the room. My sister would get very upset and say she wouldn't go to school. And I would just have this role of trying to keep everyone together and keep them from destroying each other. And I couldn't show the anger that I was feeling. My mother once said to me, "If you don't support me, then I won't have any life, anything left to live for." And I was so miserable because I felt this terrible shame when I would come home and I could smell that she was drinking. I would walk in the door and there was this smell of alcohol and there were glasses behind the peanut butter jar. So I felt terrific shame and anger. I felt I can't have any friends to this house, you know. And but I couldn't say anything about it. No one could talk about it. And the one time I tried, as I say, my mother then says, "Well, I don't have anything to live for anymore." And so I just tried to, you know, do my work and be nice to everyone as best I could, but there was this terrible tension because I just couldn't tell everyone how much I hated this.
So, why was she drinking?
Well, of course, you never know what causes people to drink. I don't claim to know. And later in her life, she became a big worker for Alcoholics Anonymous, and she helped many people recover. And she believed their philosophy that you had to admit that there was something in you that was powerless over alcohol, and you just had to acknowledge that. I guess I feel that her life with my father wasn't the life she really wanted. She had been an interior designer, and she had done really interesting work during the war on interior design, and she was in love with the man that she was working with, and he was married, and they had a long love affair, but in the end, he wasn't going to leave his wife, so she had some sort of a breakdown, and then, recovering from that, she met my father, who really, really loved her, and she married him. But my sister and I think that she was always really in love with the other guy. Mm-hmm. And she kept in touch with him. When his wife died, he said he wanted to marry her, and that was after my father had died. No, they didn't get married, no. He was 85 by then, and she just said, I'm not going to take care of an invalid. And I was sad, because I thought romance should win out in the end, and, you know, she should do it. But anyway, she didn't. So I think she was just not truly happy with my father, and she didn't have anything to do. I mean, there she was. When I was a little kid, this apartment we lived in was on a big estate, and so she was stuck in the middle of nowhere with no neighbors and no one to talk to. And then later, when we had the house, it was in these sort of ritzy suburbs and these snooty people whom she didn't like. And again, she had no one to talk to. She had no friends. So it wasn't until when she joined Alcoholics Anonymous, then she suddenly was able to put her life to use, and she was able to be responsible for people who needed her, and she had friends, and she herself was from a very aristocratic social background, but she never cared about that, and she was stuck in this aristocratic life, and she wanted always, I think, to have friends from different social classes and different backgrounds. But my father was, you know, so keen. He was from a poor family in the South, and he was so keen on rising in society, and that didn't interest her at all. So when she joined AA, she suddenly automatically got into contact with people from all over. And at her funeral, the thing that made me the most happy at her funeral was that these people came to speak, and some were black and some were white, and they were, you know, lower class and upper class. One was an actor and another was a nurse, and, you know, and they were just the people that were real to her, and that were, she had a real emotional rapport with these people. And I think when I was a kid, she never had that with anyone except her own family.
You're coming in. Your mother's drinking, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
The smell of alcohol. You can't talk to anybody. You try to compromise in the family, yeah?
Yeah.
Didn't you experience the feeling, why is she drinking? Doesn't she care about me? Am I, my sister, not good enough, and the other family members, not good enough for a wonderful life? Why?
Yeah, I guess I did. I think I tried to repress those thoughts, because I think what I really felt, what I remember feeling, was that she should take charge of her life. And she shouldn't let herself slide like this, because I was always brought up, particularly by my father, to believe that you never let down, that when you felt weak, you just overcame that, and just like he would take me through the waves and so on. So, you know, when anything happened, sickness or anything, you just used your will and you overcame that. And so he would go to the office even when he was sick. In fact, when he died, he had cancer. He had lost about a third of his weight, and he went to the office every single day. And when he died, he was putting his papers into his briefcase, and he just, you know, fell over and died. So that's the way he lived, and that's the way he taught me to live. And what I felt is, this is what I'm doing,
This is what Daddy is doing. We take charge of our lives, and we go on, and I always get my work done and do the best I can. And then on the other side were my mother and my sister. My sister had a lot of problems in school. She was younger, and I think she was more wounded by all the things in the family. So she would pretend she was sick, and she wouldn't go to school, and she'd hold the thermometer next to the light bulb so it would heat up, so she would be sick. And I just was furious at them because I thought that they could take charge of their lives by will, and they weren't doing it, you know. And I think a lot of my life after that has been learning that that's not true of people. And I write now, I mean, the article that I was writing when my mother was dying was about mercy and why the criminal justice system should have mercy on defendants whose backgrounds have hurt their chances to be good. But I think this is all about my attitude to my mother, because I didn't have mercy on her at that time.
In your childhood.
In my childhood. I was furious at her for doing this to us, and I couldn't say it. No one could say anything, but then this anger just built up inside of me, and I wanted to get rid of this anger, but I had no way of doing it. I sometimes I would pray to have this anger removed from me, and I just didn't. I thought sometime I might really do something terrible. I couldn't tell what I would do, but I just held all this anger inside me. And even now, you know, I can never, almost never, can I just say to somebody, I'm really, really angry at you. It's very hard for me. I have one friend to whom I will just say, I'm very, very angry at you. And it's such a great pleasure, you know. It's the most tremendous pleasure in life, because usually I find myself holding it in and I say very calmly, well, do you think that you might have said this or that? But I feel that if I say I'm really angry, then somebody will die. Because my mother told me that if I got angry at her, she would die. And so I write a lot about the control of anger, and I think this is the reason that I have always found this the most terrible problem.
She was blackmailing you.
Oh, well, I don't know, you know, I think...
Perhaps not deliberately, but...
Oh, you know, I'm sure that's what one would say. My own feeling was that she was suffering terribly, and that probably she would die. I mean, she just didn't have any source of support, and I had been built into her life in that way, that I was her big source of support, and so I'm sure that people who talk about codependence would say that she's blackmailing me, but I just felt she needed me, and I had to be what she wanted me to be, or she would die. And, well, I was so happy when she finally, like when I was 24 or something, she went to AA, and then she admitted that she needed help from other people. But that was a very long time. It was like 15 years of my life. And it went even through my wedding, you know, introducing her to my husband's family, all of it. And of course, they saw right away that she was an alcoholic, but they couldn't talk about it either. And so it was just like this horrible feeling that we're supposed to have a wedding now, and I'm embarrassed that my mother is there.
Anger. At the same time, did you love her?
Oh, of course.
Was it your father who was...
Oh, I love them both in very different ways. I mean, Mommy was a tremendously warm and loving person. And she really did know how to give unconditional love. And she really loved me and my sister very, very much. And later in life, when I was able to calm down and get back into a good relationship with her, I was able to see that and recover something of what I felt when I was very little, when I feel that she, you know, held me in a very loving way. My father, it was different. It was like a big romance. He was not a calm and reassuring type of a person, but he was a big challenge, and it was a sense of mutual exhilaration and mutual delight. He was always very proud of me, and he just he loved to take me to school. He also loved to take me shopping and buy me nice clothes. And so I thought I was both the child who was supposed to excel and be excellent, but I was also someone he just delighted in. I mean, he liked to see me have a new dress. And so it was a very, you know, in some ways, very romantic relationship. And I would go places with him. When he lectured for the Practicing Law Institute, I'd always be there in the audience. And I played games in the sense that everyone at the Practicing Law Institute would wear some dark gray suit, and even the women would be wearing a dark gray suit. So I'd show up in a pink mini dress with fishnet stockings, and I'd sit there in the front row, you know.
You're talking as if you are reliving.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, I mean, of course, I think I've talked about this with my partner, that, you know, my relationships with men are certainly patterned on that, and the kind of delight and humor and so on that I have with this man that I love, I know that it has a lot to do with that, and that he did so much for me in that sense, because he really set me on a path of just being happy and delighted with life, but also having great determination. And I think that the lesson he gave me of never giving up was very, very important. I mean, I do have to say he was just so wrong about society, and he was wrong about race. But there was something right in the sense that, for me, I had a lot of adversity, a lot of reversals. I've encountered sex discrimination. I've encountered sexual harassment, all these things. But I always kept going, and I felt like I never wanted to just give up or give in. And I think that has been probably more important than anything else in my career, you know. I mean, lots of people have talent, and I think the real difference is how much will they have. I really, I do believe that my father's sense that, you know, you go into the classroom, you sit down at the table and write, no matter what happens, you do that. That's more important than anything else for me, because once you have that, then the whatever you want to express, you can express it in that structure. But if you don't have the structure, then your expression will just get undermined by the sorrows that you have, I think. So, yes, he loved me terrifically. He never said, "I love you." He never was the sort of person to do that. And he never expressed his negative emotions about anything. So when he knew he had cancer and he was dying, I just wanted to say, "I love you, and I hate it that you're dying." When I came to see him, he had this operation to remove his gallbladder, and of course they knew they hadn't gotten all the cancer. I wanted to cry and hug him, but I knew that that would be terrible. He would hate that, and we couldn't do that. And so we talked about Philadelphia politics, and we had this argument, you know, because he was still this right-wing Republican, and he was backing Frank Rizzo, this police chief who was running for mayor. But I remember, it's so strange, I remember that when I was sitting on the side of his bed in the hospital, and we were having this argument, and then we started talking about Nixon, and somehow or other, he started criticizing Nixon, and I didn't expect this at all. I thought we'd have the usual argument, you know, and I would defend Humphrey, and, well, I didn't like Humphrey that well, but he was better than the alternative, right? And we would argue about race, and we'd argue about Nixon. But he started attacking Nixon, and he said he was a crook, and that was one thing he couldn't stand. He might agree with his politics, but he couldn't stand the dishonesty, so he said, "I think I'm going to vote for Humphrey." And I You know, it's funny, but I think he I felt like that was sort of like his way of saying that he loved me. That he was just listening to what I said. And he couldn't say, I am afraid of dying and I love you. But he said, I think I'm going to vote for Humphrey. So then he went home and he just went on to the office, and 6 months later he was putting his papers into his briefcase, and he just did, the cancer had reached his heart or whatever it does, and then he just fell over and died. And so that was that. But I thought that somehow or other we had been able to say I love you in our own way.
Humphrey.
Well, the other thing was that by that time I had married a Jew, and that he didn't like that either. I mean, he was very racist in all kinds of ways, and the fact that I converted to Judaism, that didn't bother him one way or the other. He was sort of interested in different religions, and he thought he might become a Buddhist one time. But it was the ethnic and social aspect that he disliked, and he didn't come to the wedding. He said he refused to come to the wedding. My parents were divorced by then, and I saw that he did come in and sit in the back, but then he didn't come to the reception. But when he was dying, the other thing he did do was he met my husband, and he talked to him, and we had some very good times together. And I knew that once they met each other, they would get along very well, because they were so alike. They were both terribly stubborn and very, and they had the same sense of humor, you know. And I had always counted on that when I married somebody that he didn't like. I thought, well, this will last a few years, but then he'll never say so, but he'll change.
Mm-hmm.
Because he always was like that. He never would say he was wrong, but somehow he would change. When I wanted to have a dog when I was little, he'd say, no dog. And then suddenly one day, somehow there was a change, and he never said I was wrong, but then I had a dog. So I knew he would be that way. But I didn't know he was going to die so soon, and no one expected that, because he was so healthy and strong. He would run and walked miles and miles. He was much older than my mother, so he was 71 when he died. But no one would have expected it, and so we didn't have long for him to get to know my husband. And yet they did. They did get to know each other. And he never, of course, saw his granddaughter.
There was so beauty and consolation in your childhood. You're talking about your dad.
I think what
he
I remember...
He was the symbolization of it, or not?
I think he symbolized beauty and wonder, I would say. Wonder is the word that I would use. Just the sense of the excitement of being in the ocean with him, the excitement of going for a long walk in the mountains. Consolation. I would think of my mother. I mean, my mother would hold me and console me. But my father was the sense of erotic excitement and adventure.
Well, you're talking about your father, childhood, his stories, swimming. It's kind of as if he's here at the very moment.
Yeah. Well, I still feel that sense of exhilaration and excitement and adventure. You know, I can remember so many things. I remember that his favorite poem was this poem, The Shooting of Dan McGrew, by Robert Service. So one day I did a tape recording of it, and he read the poem while I played the piano, because in the poem there is a stranger who comes in out of the cold and plays the piano, and the poem describes how the music sounds. And so I just took a Beethoven sonata, which of course is certainly not what they were playing in the Yukon while they were mining for gold, but that's all I knew how to play. And I played this third movement of the Pathetique Sonata in the way that the poem described the different moods, you know, rising and falling. And then at the end, there's supposed to be a woman. It says a woman screamed and the lights went out, and then there's a gunshot. And so my sister did those. So sound effects. And then, so we had this family recording of that. But my father, he read it so wonderfully, and he always read wonderfully, even when I was very little, when I was about four. He made a record for me for my birthday. He went to a recording studio, and he recorded, because there were no tape recorders in those days, he recorded my favorite story, which was about a big brown bear named Bruin. And this was a story that every Saturday morning I would get into my parents' bed in between them, and we'd tell this story, and my father would act it out, and he was the big brown bear. So he went to a recording studio, and he actually made a record of that story for me, and I have never been able to find it. I'm so mad that I can't find that, and I can't find this record of the shooting of Dan McGrew. But I do feel that he's here, sure. I do. I feel that the sense of happiness and exhilaration and excitement I have... especially when I'm in love with somebody, I feel he's very much a part of that.
Yeah? Especially then?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, very much.
Why?
Yeah. Oh, well, I think I look for people who inspire me with that sense of excitement and adventure.
His sense of.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, I've always looked for people who... that... inspire me with that sense of wonder and excitement, and therefore also people that I look up to and really admire their dedication and their capacity for hard work and absolutely uncompromising honesty. All the things that I associated with him are what I look for. The funny thing that he would not be so pleased by, though, is that I always look for people in ethnic groups that were different. I mean, either Jewish or, in one case, a man from India. And I guess it's because, actually, I always thought of my father as being different from the surrounding society, because here he was this outsider from Georgia, and he was in the Philadelphia society, but he was much more alive, and he would always make jokes about social conventions and social forms. So I thought of him as an outsider, as a kind of rebellious outsider. And actually, he even looked Jewish, because he had a fall from a horse when he was about 40 and his nose was broken. And so if you look at pictures when he was very young, his nose is sort of straight. But when I knew him, he had this hooked nose. So, you know, I thought that he probably really was Jewish. He just didn't know it.
Yeah. You're 60 now, or 14, while talking about him. Do you remember his voice, how he told the story? Can you imitate him?
Well,
or the poem? Do you still know it by heart?
Yeah. A bunch of the boys were whooping it up at the Malamute Saloon. The kid who handled the music box was playing a jagtime tune. You know, I don't remember it all, but that's how it begins. He often told stories while he was driving, so I could see him driving in the car and kind of shoulders like this and telling these stories. And then we'd sing also the songs like, you know, there's this one with lyrics by Rudyard Kipling. He loved these kind of old English adventure things. There's one, The Road to Mandalay, you know, on the road to Mandalay, where the flying fishes play, and the dawn comes up like thunder out of China across the bay. And so we would sing these terrible songs and just have a wonderful time driving along in the car. And, you know, the other thing that I remember about him was that he did love clothes. As I said, he always had beautiful suits and ties. And he had about 150 ties. I once counted them. So sometimes I would just come in and look at his clothes. And he had many, many shoes. He would polish all the family's shoes every week because he thought it was very important that the shoes should be well polished. So he'd gather up all the shoes, and then we would have this great time, and he would tell stories while he was, you know, buffing the shoes. And so I would just hang around. There was a time I could hang around in his room and smell the shoe polish. And, you know, so I still, when I smell shoe polish, it always reminds me of those Friday evenings when he would polish all the shoes.
Yeah. I want to know, you wrote about the death of your mother.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it. But compared to the death of your father, what happened to you when he died?
Oh, it was really, really hard for me. Because I, as I say, partly because of this marriage thing that I had assumed when I decided to go ahead and get married to somebody that he didn't want me to marry, I assumed that there was plenty of time and that there was a lot of time for him to change his mind, and I knew he would. When I thought that this was so ridiculous because he had all these stereotypes about Jews, that they were vulgar and they smoked big cigars, and I thought, foolishly enough, that when he met the individual family and saw that they didn't conform to any of those stereotypes, then everything would be fine. Well, it wasn't fine. He didn't even want to meet them, but I knew that sooner or later he would, and that when he came off of his stubbornness, he would. But then when I recognized that he only had 6 months to live, I felt tremendous guilt, like I had, you know, injured my relationship with him at the very end of life, and in a way that it turned out it was much more irrevocable than I thought. Now, I went on seeing him in that period, but I also knew he was very lonely because my parents had been divorced. He was living in an apartment of his own. He was semi-retired from his law firm. He was still working, but I knew that the work was never very satisfying to him. He was a very successful tax lawyer, but he had always wanted to be a scientist, and they were poor, and he had to support his younger brothers and sisters, so he didn't get a chance to go on and get that education. He was practicing law by the time he was 21 in Georgia, and he just never could go back. So his work was never what he wanted to do, and I knew that he would have wanted to spend time with me and a husband, but so I felt a kind of guilt. I mean, I knew that I was right and he was wrong, but I still felt guilt because I had taken him away from my life at a time which turned out to be the end of his life. But then, when he did die, I didn't know what one should do. What I wanted was I wanted to put on black, and I wanted to wear black to show what I felt. But, you know, in our society, there isn't any ritual of mourning that you can do. And so, and here he was divorced, and there weren't very many friends that he had. He was a rather shy man, really, except with his family. And so there weren't very many people I could talk to about him. Of course, I could talk to my husband, but he had very, understandably, very mixed feelings about my father. And even my half-brother, my father had been married before, and I have a half-brother who's 15 years older than me, he hated my father because he felt his own mother had been mistreated by him. It was a very brief marriage, and they got quickly divorced, and this half-brother was raised by his mother. So I couldn't talk to him because he hated my father. My sister also hated my father because she felt like he always preferred me and didn't really love her. And to this day, she kind of likes to believe that she might not really be his daughter. She looks for evidence that she really looks like this man that my mother was in love with before. And, you know, so she's created this fantasy that she might not really be my father's daughter. So I couldn't talk to her about it. So what was I to do to say that I really loved him? Well, the only thing I could do was really to do my work, because he always was so proud of me, whatever I did. And although he thought philosophy was kind of useless, he kept asking what use it was, he was so proud when I had some success and so happy. And in fact, just before his death, I had become the first woman to be a junior fellow in the Harvard Society of Fellows. And I asked for permission to tell him that before the official publication date of the awards, because he was dying, and they did tell me that I could do that. And so he knew about this just before he died.
How did he react?
Of course, he was very, very happy. He was very, very happy. And I think it made a difference to him at the end of his life, because it meant kind of that I was going to do things that he had wanted to do. And I saw him after that, but once only. And he didn't want to be seen a whole lot at the very end because he looked so thin and he had lost so much weight. But I told him by phone. The hall in my little apartment, I told him. So I remember that very well. And then I saw him once more, and he was just so shriveled, and his beautiful suits, he loved fine suits, and he always had them tailor-made. And these beautiful suits were just hanging around him, and his liver was affected, his face was very yellow. So I saw him that once more, and then after the funeral, I remember this terrible, terrible time when my brother and his wife came down, and my husband and I went with them, and we divided up his furniture. And I remember two things. First, just how unpleasant and terrible it was because they didn't love him, and they really just were concerned for what pieces of furniture they should get. And then I had to be concerned also for what furniture I should get, just because I wanted some of the things he loved to be with me, you know, and therefore be loved rather than be with them and be hated. But the other thing I remember was that I thought that I might be pregnant, and I didn't know, but I kept thinking, why haven't I gotten my period? And so, and in fact, I was pregnant
at that time.
And so it turned out that I was pregnant, and my daughter was. So he died in January, and so all this stuff happened in February, and then my daughter was born the next October. So probably, I mean, I can't quite say that I planned it, because I didn't. I had an IUD, and it had come out of place, but who knows how the body works in such times, and you know, whether it came out of place in some way that had to do with my emotions, who knows. But I think that there was some connection in my emotions, because I did feel like wanting to have a child was very closely connected with this mourning and wanting life to go on. So I remember on the way back from this furniture thing, we had put some furniture into my brother's car, but the car had some problem, and the back window was broken, and it had to be taped up with some plastic. And I was lying down, holding the plastic with one hand, but I was lying across some of the furniture, because somehow or other I was in the back of this station wagon, and I had to, you know, lie down. And I remember how uncomfortable it was just jolting along, because I, as it turned out, I was pregnant, and I felt ill, and there was some sort of fumes coming up from the car, and I wondered if we were all going to be poisoned. And here I was holding this plastic with one hand and lying across the furniture. It was one of the most just physically uncomfortable hours that I'd ever spent. So I remember after that, I wrote my papers. I was a graduate student, and I was starting to write stuff that was good, and I guess it was right around then that I wrote the first article that I wrote that was ever published.
About?
It was actually about Heraclitus, one of the pre-Socratics, and his conception of the soul. It was about, you know, the connections between the soul and personal mortality. I mean, I was trying to argue that he did not have a conception of immortality, but that the way you replaced the absence of immortality was by good deeds in this life. So I suppose that could be very much connected with what I was thinking about my father. So I wrote that article, and I wrote it while I was pregnant, and then eventually it came out, I guess, right around the time that my daughter was born, 1972. In
1992, 20 jaar later, overlijdt de moeder van Martha Nussbaum. De alcoholiste die ooit haar leven afhankelijk maakte van de onvoorwaardelijke steun van haar dochter. Als jij me niet meer steunt, heb ik niets meer om voor te leven. Vlak voor onze ontmoeting heeft Nussbaum me de inleiding gestuurd van haar boek over de emoties. De inleiding begint met een verhaal van hoop en verdriet, woede en liefde, zoals ze beschrijft. Het verhaal over de dood van haar moeder en de poging van haar dochter om die te verwerken. Hebben we het over schoonheid? In ieder geval over een poging tot verzoening en troost.
She had had a number of illnesses, but none really terrible. We knew she had some heart trouble, and she had had a bypass, which was pretty successful. But then she went into the hospital to have a tumor removed from her esophagus. They found that it was malignant, but they also felt that they had got it in time, and that it was a very small tumor. So I had been scheduled to go to Trinity College Dublin to give a series of lectures. I stayed in the country while she had the operation, and then she was recovering in the intensive care unit. So everything looked just fine, and so I thought, well, since that's all going well, then I will go off for 3 days to Ireland, and then I'll come see her when she comes out of the hospital, because that's what she wanted. She really didn't want a whole lot of people flocking around while she was in the hospital. I called one time just to find out how things were going, and that was just, I guess, just after my first lecture. And suddenly, they told me that she'd had a complication during the night. The incision between the esophagus and the stomach had broken open. And of course, that's not a sterile area, so she had immediately developed a massive internal infection and fever. And they hadn't even known that the incision had come open until the fever was the symptom. So in other words, it was quite far advanced by the time they found it. So here she was, one of the best hospitals in the world, University of Pennsylvania Hospital, and they were doing everything they could for her, but they were not confident that they could catch the infection before it killed her. So, I mean, that just floored me. I mean, the terrible surprise when I thought everything was fine and that suddenly she was, her life was in danger. So I rushed around with my host, Bill Lyons, who also writes on emotions, by the way, and he helped me get a flight, but the next flight I could get, I think this was actually afternoon of the day of the second lecture by now, and, you know, given the time difference, we couldn't get another transatlantic flight till the next morning. So we got me on that flight, and then I just gave the second lecture. I mean, what else was I going to do? I was there, stuck there in Dublin, and so, and it happened that the second lecture was about emotions. So for me, this was really so strange and terrible, because I was standing up there doing this performance about emotions, and my mother was dying. So I gave it, and I didn't break down. I mean, I just And then I
what
felt,
were we talking about?
Well, and it was about the emotions. It was, later was part of my book, Poetic Justice. The lecture series was based on that book, and so this was the chapter that's now called Rational Emotions in that book. It was about the relationship between belief and emotion. But I thought, it's inhuman. I shouldn't be able to do this, and I was able to do it. So I was feeling guilty also all the time, and I thought, well, of course I should do this. I mean, here I am. Why, you know, why should I not do it? The audience is there, and they want to have the lecture. So, but I still felt there was something wrong about doing it, and so I did it. And then I went back to my room in this room in Trinity College, which I remember very well. And I had my laptop because I had a very big public lecture I had to give about 2 weeks later. Here at the University of Chicago, in fact, or I wasn't teaching here yet, but I had to give what's called the Dewey Lecture at the University of Chicago Law School. And usually I write things way ahead of time, but in this particular case, I hadn't written it very far in advance, so I had taken the laptop in order to write it, and it was a lecture about mercy, about how understanding the particular circumstances of someone's life is connected with having mercy for that person. So I went back to my room, and I actually had to write some pieces of that lecture. I did something, and actually, it was one of my best articles. So I was able to do something. But then I tried to sleep, and then I had this dream. My mother appeared, and she looked so beautiful. She looked like in these pictures that I have when I was a little girl. I was around 2, and my mother looked so beautiful, and I think she was wearing a tennis dress or something like that, and she had appeared, when she first appeared, she was lying in her hospital bed, and she was curled into a fetal position, but she still looked very beautiful. So I looked at her in the dream, and I said, "Beautiful Mommy." And Mommy was a name that I hadn't used since about age 10 when I decided it was more appropriate to say Mother. And then she stood up and she looked healthy and young, and she said, well, others might call her wonderful, but she very much preferred to be called beautiful. And so she was happy, and I'd done something to make her happy. And then I woke up, and well, of course, then I realized that my wishes hadn't made her well, and I didn't know what was going to happen. And so then I just got on the plane, and well, again, I guess today you could telephone from the plane and you could find out what's going on, but in those days you couldn't when you were over the ocean. And so I hadn't even realized this. I thought somehow you could always call, and I suddenly realized that I was out of contact and I couldn't find out what was going on. So I just sat there, and I was in this terrible state of fear, but I worked on this lecture. What else could I do? I'm trying to write about what Aristotle and the Stoics thought about mercy. And then I got there, and I called from the airport. I talked to my sister, and she had made a hotel reservation for me, and the arrangement was that I would stay in Philadelphia until this crisis resolved itself. So I called the hospital from the airport, and I was told by them that my mother had died 20 minutes before. Well, I went to the hotel and dropped off my stuff and then walked over to the hospital. And, I mean, I couldn't believe that this had actually happened. I ran to the hospital as though something could still be done. And I just ran through these streets in South Philadelphia and got there, and then I couldn't find the intensive care unit. And I remember these nurses went past this cafeteria where everyone was laughing and talking. And then they showed me into the intensive care unit, and there, behind a curtain, I saw my mother, and she was lying in bed. And, you know, every night at home, she would lie in bed on her back, wearing some nice bed jacket or gown, and she always looked very nice. And so she was just lying there on her back the way that she looked every night at home, and she was wearing a nice robe with a lace collar, and they had put on her makeup, so she looked very good, because the nurses told me they were very fond of her, and they knew that it was very important to her to have her makeup on straight. She always checked her makeup. But the difference was that there was this thing in her nose. It was like a breathing tube, but then I could see it wasn't hooked up to anything. I can't describe what it was to see that. I just cried, and I cried. I couldn't stop crying, and I remember the nurses brought me water, and so I just stayed there for a while and cried, and then they put all this stuff in a bag for me, and there was this red suitcase, which I still have in my closet here, but I never can use that suitcase. And there was this red suitcase, and they put all this stuff in it, like her bed jackets and the books, and I had given her some books to read in the hospital. There was this one novel by Barbara Pym called A Glass Full of Blessings, and I don't like that book. I think it's kind of precious and cute, but it was the kind of book I knew my mother would like, and she did tell me on the phone that she had enjoyed it. So this novel was in there, and all these relics, and I didn't know what I was supposed to do with these, but they put me into the hospital van with these things, and they took me back to the hotel. So when I got to the hotel, well, I remember, because the first thing I did was to call my partner. I mean, I was already involved with this same guy in those days, and I talked to him for a long time. And I, you know, every so often I get, even now, into this feeling of terrible guilt, like, why wasn't I there? Why was I in Ireland giving these lectures? Did I really not love her enough? And of course I know, you know, that I was so angry at her through a lot of my childhood, so I've had a lot of guilt about my own anger always. And he always says to me, I heard your voice when you called me, and you really loved her so much. And whenever you talked about her, he says, I know that you really loved her. And so that's very, you know, I still need to be consoled, not just for the death, but even more for my own anger and my sense of guilt. And he consoles me, and he tells me, you really loved her. And so I talked to him, and then I went over to the University of Pennsylvania track, and I went running because there was this good track there, and I really felt I had to go running. And so I ran around this track, and actually I felt more energetic than usual because I guess they're adrenaline or something. But I ran for 4 miles or so, and then I had a small plate of spaghetti, and then I went to bed. And I went back home the next day, and it took a very long time to really realize that she was dead, because I would start picking up the phone, and I would think I was going to call her and tell her what happened, and then I would see that image of her lying in the hospital bed with the tube coming out of her nose, and so I would have to keep reminding I would keep being reminded that she was dead. And again, like with my father, I did not know what to do to show my mourning. I felt like, I still feel, our society has no room for mourning. They do not know what you are supposed to do. I wanted to just hide away in the house and not go and do anything. And I had this lecture to give, and I thought, how cruel and inhumane to give such a lecture. It was because I was lecturing that I wasn't there when my mother died, and I almost felt like maybe she wouldn't have died if I hadn't been away, you know. And so I thought, I can't give this lecture. But then everyone said to me, well, of course you have to give this lecture. I mean, we're all counting on it. You were writing it. And so I then, of course, I had to finish writing it. And I think even that lecture, which was not really connected with my mother in my conscious mind, I think in my unconscious mind, it surely was, because it was all about how to overcome anger with a kind of mercy that derives from the fact that you look at the circumstances of human life and you see how many obstacles people have to overcome. And so the idea was that when you see how hard it is to live a good life, then you are less likely to be angry at people, and you're more likely to be compassionate and merciful. There's this one part where I talk about Seneca.
That applied to your mother also, her life.
Yeah, I mean, I think it happened.
I applied it to
my mother. That is to say that it was my own way of stating how I felt about my mother, but it also applied to my relation to myself, I think, because there was this one part in the middle of it where Seneca says that in order to be merciful to other people, you also have to have a different attitude to yourself, and he describes how he examines himself at the end of every day and all the things he did wrong, and then he says, see that you don't do that again. This time I pardon you. And, you know, when I read that, it always makes me cry, even though it might be in the middle of a public lecture, because I think it's because I want to pardon myself, you know. And I feel like that's a way of saying that even though you do have these aggressive wishes, there's a way in which you can let yourself off the hook by reminding yourself that human life is very hard, and you do have ambivalent feelings and wishes, but perhaps also that through writing about this, I was, you know, making reparation to my mother and helping to express love, and in that way to atone for what bad wishes I had had.
If you talk about emotions.
I have to wipe my nose. Yes, I have to wipe my nose. If I do that because I'm crying, my nose is running. Yeah. So.
Did you discover any conclusions you were not aware of? You said, oh, dear Martha, what?
Exploring this whole area was very important to me, and it really made me think of my relation to my mother in a new way in turn. I mean, issues that I hadn't thought about much, about guilt and reparation for guilt, became a very big part of what I was writing, and this idea of giving to the world something that comes out of your own struggle with your own anger and guilt and so on, that's what, to me, the concept of reparation is all about. I'm always very moved by the analysts like Melanie Klein and her followers who talk about the way that the young child solves the terrible crisis of recognizing that it has ambivalent feelings towards parents through the idea of reparation, through the idea that you can pay back, even if you have aggressive wishes towards someone you love, you can pay back by giving something back, by making reparation. And Klein says you do this not just directly toward the person, but you do it in all of your life through trying to create something that gives something to humanity. I think she quite plausibly says that the source of the urgency that underlies a lot of our creative projects comes from the feelings of guilt we have, that we've done a wrong and there's something that needs to be atoned for.
A terrible feeling of guilt.
Yeah, a terrible feeling
all of guilt. Every day's lifetime. And
yeah, yes. And that the way you discharge this, though, is to create something that may give the world back something good. So I do feel a lot of my suffering, whenever I have suffering, whether it's about death of someone or about something where I feel I might not be a good enough mother or something, it all revolves around guilt, and guilt that has something to do with my own aggressive impulses and wishes. And for me, therefore, the most consoling thing in the world is to be able to discharge that guilt by doing something good. And whatever that can be, and for me it always takes the form of some kind of writing, something through the projects that I undertake, because I think that just happens to be the way that I as a person am most capable of doing good. I think by consolation I would mean coming to terms with some powerful loss, trying to assimilate it, trying to move on through it and from it. And for me, works of art have a very deep role in consolation, but it's not because they're beautiful, but it's often because they depict grief and helplessness in an extremely agonizing way. Now, I suppose one could use beautiful to describe that experience, but it wouldn't be the most natural word. I mean, the Kindertotenlieder of Mahler. Now, to me, that is music that's immensely powerful. And in the time when I was grieving for the death of my mother, I listened to it again and again. It just happened that I took only about 3 CDs to Finland, for where I was for a month that summer following her death, and that was one of them. And I listened to that until I couldn't stand it anymore, and then I listened to another one, which was Mozart's Exultate Jubilate. And then I went running, listening to that one in my head. I mean, in my head, because I never listen to music while I'm running. But you know, what I would say is that music is consoling because it brings you to terms with the finality of loss in such an eloquent way. Now, I wouldn't have said of the Kindertotenlieder, that's a beautiful work. I think most listeners wouldn't use that word. It's a harrowing work, but it's precisely for that reason that it's consoling, I think. And I think one helpful comparison is between music and dreams. And this is something that Proust developed in a very interesting way, I think. That music, because it doesn't follow a usual narrative temporal sequence in a way that a work of literature does, the way in which emotions will be depicted has a phantasmagoric and dreamlike character. One emotion succeeds another very rapidly. They're wound up together in strange ways. And so in that way, what I suggest is music can often cut beneath the habits of everyday life and have access to powerful emotions that are buried beneath the routines of habit. We form our deepest emotions at a time when our inner life is rather dreamlike. That is, when we're such small infants that we can't speak and we aren't part of society yet. And I think that music has some of the power it does because it's able to tap those deeper layers of the personality and bring back to us some of the intense and extremely sharp but also archaic and unfocused emotions of childhood. So in that way, it's more able than is a lot of literature to jolt us out of our sense of normalcy, our sense that we're just going about in the world using language in the usual and habitual way. So there's a way in which music pierces like a beam straight to the most vulnerable parts of our personality. When Mahler was conducting his own work, he described this experience saying, a burning pain crystallizes. And I think that's the experience that I often have with music, that there is a kind of pain in the personality somewhere, buried too deep for words, and music doesn't just reproduce it, but in some way does crystallize it. It gives it a form, but a form that's not the form of daily conversation, and it's precisely for that reason that it has the power that it does.
Your mother did help you a lot, didn't she?
Yeah. She did.
Yeah, recognizing and...
Yeah. Yeah, and, I mean, I heard this song so many times after her death, and I think it was a way that I had of taking it in. It was a way I had of telling myself that this was final. But that's, I think, what we have to do if we are to have a life after a death, is to see it as a death, not to see it as something else, not a death. So, to me, the greatness of Mahler is in his getting to the very depths of the inexorability of loss and the real deep pain that human life affords. And I think if you can't get to the depth of that pain, you also can't get to the heights of the joy of human life.
Well, we're just to the fifth.
Yeah.
Do we still have time? Okay, yeah, you can start.
Just push five.
Die Kinder hinaus. was little Martha Nussbaum, the angry kid. Where did you leave her?
Oh, in that song. Well, I think that song picks up on, I think it has, a lot of the power it has is from the way it mines the combination of anxiety and guilt we have about people we love. And I think the way that I relate to it is probably through my feelings of anxiety and guilt towards my mother, that she is, as it were, the children whom I should have protected but perhaps didn't do so well enough. And that sense that you ought to protect someone and you haven't managed to do it gives rise to a terrible hammering inside your own personality. And I think what makes that song so devastatingly powerful for me is that way that it captures the way the personality hammers and persecutes itself for the fact that the loved ones have come to grief and you haven't done anything about it. And then, of course, the bleak moment where the stroke comes, and then after that everything is hushed and ethereal. Soon the voice itself stops, the oboe, which was associated with the human world, stops, and we just have the strings for the last 16 bars or so. And what does that mean? I think it means that the loved one is gone, is in the world of nature, and that's that. And you have not been able to do anything. So, but I think confronting those emotions in that song is a powerful way of coming to terms with the finality of loss and the sense of, I think, mourning is so often accompanied by guilt, but certainly in my case it was, the sense that I ought to have been much, much better. I shouldn't have had this anger. I shouldn't have been away lecturing and Ireland, and maybe I shouldn't even have been a philosopher, because there was something unloving about that, my mother always thought. So all of these forms of guilt are in me, and to try to understand them, I feel, is one of the things I derive from that terrible song.